This is Frank Morano on Talk Radio 107.1 and on WABCRadio.com. One of my favorite people to talk to, and he's been one of my favorite people to talk to on the air and off the air for years, is somebody that I actually met when he was substituting about 16 years ago at WABC. We were fast friends, and he's somebody who I have really enjoyed his commentary on everything from leadership to politics, but especially when it comes to his knowledge of the Godfather trilogy. And he is now not only an Emmy Award-winning anchor and not only the author of the book Lessons in Leadership, but he has recently been named to the NJ Globe Power List of New Jersey's 100 Most Influential Leaders. On the line with us right now, we have the very influential Steve Adubato. Good morning, Steve.
Frank, it's always good to talk to you, and you're about the most influential guy around when it comes to radio. Yeah, oh, wait, is Curtis listening, by the way?
He is, but I don't know that he would even dispute that.
I agree, Steve.
I want to touch base with you on I want to pick your brain on a wide variety of subjects, locally and nationally. But I love what you're doing. You're doing something called Democracy at a Crossroads, which is this series of conversations with leaders from New Jersey and not just New Jersey, but the whole region that examine the serious challenges facing our democracy right now. Now, this is something that I think everybody realizes, but not enough people spend very much time studying and talking about. How can people watch Democracy at a Crossroads, and what was the impetus for you wanting to do this?
First, where to watch it is on PBS stations in our region, WNET in New York, NJTV over here in New Jersey. And here's what Democracy at a Crossroads is about. So someone could say, wait, democracy has been at a crossroads forever. But, Frank, you and I have had so many on-the-air and off-the-air conversations about the fact that this is a different kind of democracy at a crossroads. This is a different kind of crisis in our country. It's a crisis of trust. It's a crisis of the fact that we are, you don't need me to be the one to tell you this, more polarized than ever before among citizens, among families, among friends, among the media. We are more divided, and we are at such a critical point with so many serious challenges and problems that we're facing, from the economy to COVID and small businesses that are struggling. So many things that we're facing that people don't trust the outcome of an election. So to me, our democracy, our representative democracy, is at a crossroads it's never been at before. And if we choose to decide we're going to be two countries, two sets of people who believe in two totally different realities, then I don't see how we're going to come together. I used to think, Frank, that, yeah, we all have different political points of view. We can discuss them, respect each other. But you know what? You know, not everyone's a Democrat or a progressive, Republican, conservative. That's not what we're talking about, Frank. The bottom line is we're talking about literally people who don't even acknowledge and accept who the president is going to be on January 20th. And for the last 4 years, other people who didn't accept who the current president was.
Right.
That's insanity.
Yeah, and I'm glad that you mentioned that this sort of distrust of institutions and resistance to election results is something that happens on both sides, because too often Democrats point to Republicans and say, look how dumb these guys are. They don't even believe that the election was held accurately. And then too often Republicans point to Democrats and say, hey, why should we give those guys a break? You know, they didn't give Donald Trump a break for the last 4 years. So how do these conversations further the cause of bridging that democracy gap?
Well, first of all, I want to acknowledge that, you know, yes, it has gone on both sides, and I don't like that whole, you know, it's both of them, because in all candor, Frank, while I disagree with Barack Obama on a whole range of his dealing as a leader with lots of different issues, I criticized him in my book Lessons in Leadership for his handling of certain questions and issues, but I'll say this, 2 days after President Trump was elected and he was the president-elect, even though he technically lost the popular vote, he won huge in the Electoral College. And to Barack Obama's credit, he was a statesman, country first. He had Donald Trump, president-elect, in the White House. And the reason I say that is because there were countless Democrats who didn't want Trump to be president. They acknowledged that he was president and then tried to delegitimize him, and he contributed to it as well. This is different, Frank. This is a whole set of Republicans in Congress refusing to acknowledge that Joe Biden's even going to be the president or is the president-elect. And when Putin acknowledges that Biden is the president-elect before Mitch McConnell, that's scary. Now, your second question, what are we going to do? We're going to talk to Democrats, Republicans, conservatives, liberals, people of all stripes. Give them an opportunity to say what they want, challenge them, and then force them to talk to each other. Force them to respect each other's point of view, even if they disagree with it. And I got to tell you, that doesn't sound like it's so revolutionary, but you tell me, Frank, where that's happening in a respectful, civil way. You and I disagree. We agree on The Godfather, but we don't agree on a lot of other things politically. We've never had one crossroad word with each other. We always respect each other. That's atypical and not the norm. That's why democracy is at a crossroads.
No, you're exactly right. And it's a great series. And you have one of my the people that I love in politics on one of your first shows, and somebody who's also a very good friend who was on this show just last week, former New York Governor
David Patterson.
Yeah. I'm excited to hear your discussion with David Patterson. He's got this new book out. And if there's anybody that sort of, in my view, typifies what it's like to be a nonpartisan leader, it's a guy like David Patterson. So I'm looking forward to seeing that.
That's this weekend. It's David Patterson and Congresswoman Mikey Sherrill, who is a military veteran, and both of whom are pretty mainstream, center, if you will, folks who are not on the fringes and frankly want to get stuff done. How dare they?
Tell me how you see the next 4 years, or at least the next 2 years in Washington going. It appears there's a better than even chance that we'll have a Republican Senate while we have a Democratic president and a slightly Democratic majority in the House of Representatives. How do you see divided government going for the next 2 years?
First of all, the Democrats cannot kid themselves. This was a huge victory for Joe Biden, but 74, 75 million Americans voted for Donald Trump more than any other incumbent president. That's number one. Number two, the Democrats also can't kid themselves, Frank, because they lost seats in the House in a year where Joe Biden got the most votes in the history of presidential elections. That's embarrassing, number one. Number two, those races in Georgia, and I don't like to engage too much in political prognostication, but I think it's a long shot that the Democrats win both seats. If they win one, then the Republicans will control the Senate. The Democrats will have a slight majority in the House. Unfortunately, Frank, go back to how I started. If we are as divided as we think we are, and we're going to find out with the stimulus package, and I hope and pray it passes, mostly for all the people who are struggling, mostly all the people who need $300 a month to keep things going for themselves. By the way, is it a week or a month? I don't want to screw this up.
It's a week.
It's a week. I apologize.
That's okay.
I just realized $300 a month isn't going to do much for anyone. The reason I say that is because if the Democrats and Republicans can agree on the stimulus package, it may signal, Frank, that there's reason to be hopeful. However, if the Republicans in the Senate dig their heels in and the Democrats dig their heels in and they say, we'll wait for four more years. Four more years of what? Of more gridlock? Of more blaming the other party for everything that's wrong in the country? Democrats saying it's Donald Trump's mess that he left us, and the Republicans saying we're going to wait until we can win in a couple of years? And while people are suffering, again, I repeat myself, democracy is not only at a crossroads, we're at a crisis point. We can't afford that, Frank.
Yeah.
We can't.
It's going to be very interesting to see how the next couple of days, let alone the next couple of years, pan out here. I am wondering what your judgment is of the Biden cabinet so far. I was a little surprised. I had thought that when the Republicans retained control of the Senate, that his primary focus would be on nominating people that could get confirmed. But his likely nominee for Secretary of Defense and his nominee for Office of Management and Budget, they both look like they're going to have a pretty tough time getting through a Republican Senate. I'm curious as to your take on his pick so far.
Well, first, I want to avoid getting into the weeds in this process because I don't know that much about these people other than what I read. But I'll say this. I give Biden credit for not capitulating to the far left in the Democratic Party. Those who are so far left, so quote-unquote progressive, bordering on the S word, right? Socialist. Proud of it, some of them. I got to tell you, they're peeved at him, Frank. They're peeved that many of President-elect Biden's choices come from the Obama administration, come from people who've been around Washington, whom he has known for many years. And that includes the nominee for defense secretary. Yes, they're going to have to make an exception because he wasn't out of the military long enough. And I believe, you know, the number of years is to give people some independence from the military itself. But I got to tell you something. They're pretty mainstream, if you will, choices. And the Republicans may give him trouble, but he's also going to have trouble on the far left, which to me makes me think they're pretty reasonable choices.
Were you surprised, and if people are just tuning in, we're talking with Steve Adubato. You could see him regularly on PBS. You could check out his book, Lessons in Leadership, wherever you fall on the political spectrum. It's a terrific book that goes through the world of politics, business, sports, and there's some leadership lessons we can all take from there.
And by the way, Frank, how about this one? We actually, our Lessons in Leadership program, that's on News 12 Plus every Sunday at 10 a.m. We had John Kasimatidis on, who was absolutely terrific talking about business leadership. I just wanted to plug that.
I tell you, if there's anybody that that is a case study in effective leadership, in my view, it's certainly John Kasimatidis. So people should definitely check that out if they haven't seen that already. Now, given what you've said about kind of the moderate nature of Biden's pick so far, I'm curious, were you surprised at the speech that he gave on Monday night where at the very beginning he said, yeah, you know, let's give each other a chance. I'm going to work just as hard for you if you didn't vote for me than if you did. And then he goes on a 5-minute basically harangue lambasting the Trump administration, their legal challenges and everything like that. Yeah. That struck me as sort of a bit of a dichotomy and a way to alienate a lot of Trump supporters.
So I'll go back, you know, as a student of leadership, as someone who teaches it, writes about it, tries to understand it, and makes constant mistakes as a leader. It was a mistake, and I'll tell you why. It doesn't matter what Joe Biden thinks about the lawsuits. It doesn't matter whether he believes that President Trump's not being presidential or deferential or respectful. It doesn't matter, and here's why. The thing that people are hoping and praying for with Joe Biden is that he's reasonable and that he rises above. And when he got, in my view, petty like that, even if he's accurate or thinks he's accurate, it's not strategic, meaning it wasn't useful. It wasn't helpful. Well, you know what he needs to talk about? This vaccine, how they're going to administer the vaccine, how the federal government's going to work with state and local governments to get that done effectively. He needs to talk about the economy. He needs to talk about people struggling and how to help them through this incredibly difficult time. There is no room, Frank, as a leader, particularly as a student of presidential leadership, to be going after Donald Trump, which equals the 74, 75 million people who voted for him, who are going to be peeved at you for doing that. Why? What's the benefit?
Yeah, I'm still
even if it makes them feel better.
I'm still trying to figure it out. I'll be honest. I don't understand
the
strategy, if there was one. Steve, before we let you go, want to take advantage of your expertise when it comes to Garden State politics. Next year, the governor's race is on the ballot. Governor Phil Murphy seeking a second term. There's been some controversy about some of the moves he's made in terms of handling the COVID crisis, the lockdowns, and so forth. There appears to be at least two Republicans running so far. Do you see the governor's race being competitive, and do you think the Republicans will end up with a primary themselves?
I do think the Republicans are going to wind up with a primary between Jack Cittorelli, a guy I really like and respect, a moderate Republican, and the outgoing chair of the Republican Party. Is it Doug Steinhardt?
Yeah, right? I believe so. Yes, Doug Steinhardt. Yeah.
I do think there's going to be a primary. As for Phil Murphy, the governor, right now, pretty decent polls in terms of his popularity. But here's the thing. I'm convinced that anytime you're a leader in a difficult situation, as it's been since March 13th of 2020, you have to make very tough decisions, obviously. If you want to be popular all the time, then you're not going to make the tough decisions. You'll duck them. He's made tough decisions. I don't agree with all of them, but I believe he's coming from a good place and trying to protect people. But small businesses are suffering. The economy is suffering. They borrowed $10 billion the state needed. And there was just a report, and you check out NJ.com, that just said the state was not in as dire a fiscal situation. Why do I say all this? Because I believe that Murphy's situation, when that election comes around, will largely be about where COVID is in the state, where the economy is in the state, what taxes are like in the state. And the bottom line is, talking about an election then, right now, is lunacy. I think he's probably in a good position, but let's see how things play out over the next few months.
All right.
And two solid candidates on the Republican side running against him.
And finally, Steve, as I mentioned, your godfather prowess, you talked about the need for leaders to occasionally express and speak out on unpopular issues. One of the views that I've taken publicly, one of the stances that I've taken publicly and gotten a great deal of heat for, is I don't believe that the movie The Godfather Part 3 is nearly as bad as everybody in the world seems to think it is. This is the 30th anniversary this month of The Godfather Part 3. They've re-released it. They've retitled it. They've recut it. Are you going to watch, or have you watched, the re-release of The Godfather Part 3? Why or why not?
Frank, just when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in. How could you do this to me? I thought you and I, when it came to The Godfather 1 and 2, the only ones that I recognize, that we were shoulder to shoulder, paisans, together, and you have to do this to me?
Well, look, the fact, Steve,
it's terrible.
The fact,
please, stop.
Hey, you know what movie you just quoted? You just quoted The Godfather Part 3. So obviously the movie's not that bad.
Frank.
The movie's not that bad if people are quoting it in everyday life. So you're not going to watch the re-release.
I will do it out of respect to my good friend, Frank Morano.
Thank you.
And
yes.
I will try to see the Andy Garcia role and the Pacino role, and I will try to see something good in this that I have not seen in the seven other times I've watched it.
All right. Well, we're going to have you back for your review of this retake. Steve, it is always a treat to talk with you. I hope you and your family are doing well. I hope to chat with you before Christmas. Even more so, last year, you and your family were kind enough to send me a Christmas card. It was from the Adubato _S, and I'm hoping this year...
Oh, that's right.
This year,
you hit me on that.
I will get a Christmas card without an apostrophe.
I will do that. And Frank, let me just say this as we go. I could not... On a personal note, I could not be more proud of you and what you're doing at the station. You're knocking them dead. Keeping it up, my friend.
Well, I appreciate that very much. And in all sincerity, your mentorship, your guidance, and your friendship over the last 16 years has meant a great deal. And I'm not sure where I'd be without it. So thank you.
Mentorship is just meaning I'm a lot older than you, Frank.
Much
Take
older.
Care, buddy.
Much love. The great Steve Adubato. Check him out on PBS. You can also check out his book, Lessons in Leadership. He's also worth following on Twitter.